So the next talk is about high performance, open source and high performance networks by Jeremias. Please welcome him with a big round of applause.
Hello everyone. welcome from my side as well. I'm glad that a few people showed up. It's going to be about open source and high performance networks. With high performance networks, what I want to say is, I mean these kind of boxes down here, which I would say are, as a comparison to other devices, low performance, I would say software switching or software-based networking. And there are even bigger boxes, which are basically much bigger with many, many more ports. And they are a different scale. So I'm going to specifically talk about this kind of size of a networking device. Okay, before we go into the details, I have a bit of history, which is probably not 100% accurate, but I want to motivate why I think that open source is quite important in networking. If you look at the year 2000, I remember back then I was an administrator for a firewall, and it was a Sun UltraSpark. I don't actually remember the exact model, and it ran Sun Solaris. And Solaris is a commercial operating system, and there weren't any VMs back then, and everything you did was manually, more or less, and maybe some shell scripts. Now, if you move 15 years forward, what did change? Now, as you probably know, a lot. So first of all, most of the alternative hardware is dead today. You rarely see any Sun hardware or IBM hardware anymore. There are new systems like ARM, but to my knowledge, they're not really widely deployed as of today, and as of 2015, even less. So what kind of operating systems do we have? Well, it's more or less just Linux. Everything else is not really used in computing, and of course, there are loads of management systems. So there are really cool stuff. There's virtualization, every kind of flavors. You can have virtual machines, you can have containers, and you can even have something like unikernels, which are like very, very small virtual machines. And you get all this kind of software stuff that comes with it. You can run small scripts that set up your whole network. You can use Kubernetes to configure an application and automatically start like hundreds of VMs around the globe. But that's pretty cool stuff. So I really like that. And I think this is really what progress looks like and should look like. Now, if you look at networking, what did we have in the year 2000? Again, back then, I remember we had Cisco stuff. Actually, I never saw Juniper, but apparently it existed back then as well. Then Lucent Technologies, I'm pretty sure that existed back then. About Alcatel, I'm actually not completely sure. Let's just assume they had switches as well. The average interface speed, or the good one, was 1 gigabit. And the protocols, just a few examples here, are basically spanning tree, MPLS, and the usual interior gateway protocols like IS, or OSPF. And I remember back then, if you used spanning tree, it wasn't really a pleasure, because the if something went wrong, you have to wait for a minute until everything was back to normal again. So it was not really ideal. And for management, we had CLI and, well, the dreaded expect scripts, basically automated CLI. And now, of course, we are all very excited, because we hope the same thing that happened in compute will happen in networking as well. Unfortunately, that's not the case. So if you look at the hardware and software, Alcatel, Lucent, and basically they merged together, Alcatel and Lucent, and now we're bought by Nokia. Everything else is the same. There's still Cisco, there's still Juniper. If you look at the interfaces, that's pretty cool. We now have 100 gigabit interfaces. That's pretty nice. That's a 100-fold increase. And when it comes to the protocols, it's kind of disappointing. We now have the Rapid Spanning Tree protocol, which actually works, which is nice. Then we have MPLS, and I have never used it, but people tell me now it works, and in 2000 it didn't work, which is also, it's okay, but it's not really the thing that you would expect or hope for. And I don't know if there were any big changes in the SIS or OSPF, I'm not into that too much, but they are still there, maybe some extensions. And well, the management, where was so much growth in the compute area, there's basically nothing. So we still have CLIs, we still have expect scripts. In 2015, there was already NetConf, but I remember when we tried to buy a switch at university, most of those that you could buy back then, they didn't even support NetConf. So this is really, really disappointing and really sad. And this is kind of, I don't know, the compute guys have so much cool stuff to do, and networking we don't. Of course, still the speed is very, very nice. But everything else is kind of disappointing. And one question, of course, is why. And of course, I don't have the answer to that. But I think if you compare the two right sides of the previous slides, you will see that one distinct feature is that in compute, we have basically Linux for everything. And Linux is open source. Everybody can propose their own changes. It comes with an organization that manages the progress, basically. And well, in networking, we don't have that. So my guess would be one reason is a lack of openness in terms of hardware specification and, of course, in open source. And, of course, I mean, the companies in this area, they want money. I mean, that's their job. And if they can make money without having any progress, I guess why not? That's my guess here. And apparently customers don't care. Customers don't care. I'm not really sure why. But there have been some change recently. There has been some openness. You will see that later. And I think we are now at a point maybe where the computing industry was maybe in the 90s or even in the 80s. And hopefully we will see the same progress. And of course, I mean, this progress thing is not the only thing I would hope from to get from open source, but also the usual security stuff. It's much harder to plan any backdoors in open source software than it is in closed source software. So yeah, that's my reason why I think open source would be pretty cool in networking as well. And the thing is, there are already some opportunities on how to use open source today. And my impression was at the last Chaos Communication Congresses I attended that there's not much, too much awareness of this, and there are very few talks on the matter. One exception was this demystifying network cards from Paul Emmerich, which is really, really a good talk, and which again shows the specification of the network cards that he discusses. They are open for some years now, but nobody bothered to write his own driver, and he did. So that's pretty cool. And well, the goal of the talk is basically to show you what kind of stuff you could do today with open source and open things. And my approach here is I will first give a short introduction on how I see networks work today. Then I give an overview on the APIs and specifications, and then I will go a little bit into more detail onto the different data plane API models. What that exactly is, we will see later. Okay, so how does a switch work? So we have this box, we've seen that before. Hopefully everybody of you has seen such a device before. If not, here's a picture. In this case, there are 65 ports, which is for quite a lot for such a small switch. If you open it, and this box has like 20 screws, so that's really a lot of work. You see, well, again, those ports. These are the physical encasements of these ports. And then we have this huge cooling device. And, well, I guess these are fans, but you can't really see much. So we'll have another photo. And this is from the top. Again, here in front are the ports. Here's the huge cooling device. And these are fans, and these are the power supplies. And then we have all these small things that we really can't see. So I highlighted them. And first of all, there's the forwarding chip. So all the ports are directly connected to the forwarding chip, in this case, a barefoot Tofino chip. Then we have a management port. We saw in front, which is a copper port, like a 1 gigabit usually. And then it turns out it's just a normal PC inside. In this case, it's rather a beefy computer, but still it's a normal computer. So the forwarding chip is attached to the CPU with the PCI bus. The same goes for the NIC. And so in the end, although it looks very different, in the end it's more or less just a PC with a huge, networking card. Yeah, so that's a single device. Now, how does this stuff work in a real network? I have three very small network here as an example. I have three of these devices. Now, extract it a little bit to make it more visible. And we have packets going from the bottom left here to the top right. And let's see what kind of different architectural aspects we can find here. So we have this basically this packet processing path, which we call the data plane. It's basically this ASIC thing we saw before. And this is this does all the packet handling. Then we have the control plane, which is the server, basically the x86 CPU we saw before, which is there to basically to configure the data plane. It's not involved in the packet processing. And all these small CPUs here, they run different routing protocols, and the network works in a way that all these control plane computers, they talk different routing protocols, they exchange information, and using these information about the topology of the network, for example, they configure their local ASIC and make sure the packets are forwarded in the right way. And then we have a third plane, which is the management plane. Here it's a manual thing, so if you log into your switch and configure it and change some parameters, that's what you could call the management plane. And because it's not abstract enough, we will go one step further and make it a little more abstract even. So we have a data plane with all the special chip stuff. Then we have the control plane CPU, which is like a normal PC. And we have a new thing here, which is centralized control. So there are some cases where you want either parts or the complete control plane functionality. So the functionality that decides what your chip actually does, you might want to have this on a different computer. And this is called software-defined networking, or in BGP you often use a route reflector, which is somewhat similar to that kind of thing. So the control plane actually is not only the CPU that's directly attached to the switching device, but might also be a remote server or something. And then you have the management plane, which is monitoring and usually involves human work today. So this is the overview about the network architecture as I see it. And I mentioned SDN, and I think I should quickly introduce what I mean with SDN. I think software-defined networking has been a buzzword for some years now. Usually if I talk with people who work in this area, they don't like the word, but it has actually a meaning that it goes beyond marketing. And that's why I will introduce it in the next slide. Before we go further, I will now focus on the control plane, data plane part, and skip the management plane. I know there's all the progress we saw in the compute area came from the management plane, but I think we are not there yet. We still have to figure out how to do this stuff automatically, and once this is done, you can do also a lot more in the management plane part. Okay, so what's SDN, or what's my view of what the most important feature of SDN is? We again have our small network here, now a little bit simplified. Again, data plane and control plane in one device, and they all speak this protocol to make the network work. And the idea behind that is that you have different devices from different vendors, and the standardization is through the protocol that communicate between the boxes. So you could think of a vertical, at least in this figure, a vertical standardization. Now the idea of SDN is specifically to change the orientation of the standardization, and you do that by removing the control plane part from the boxes and put it into a central location, which in this case is just a single server, but usually you wouldn't have a single server, you would have some kind of a cluster or something. So it's in general the separation of the control and data plane, and often even remotely. I mean, theoretically you could still run this on here, but then you have the same setup as in classical networks. And now the original idea of SDN was, or the hope was, which I think didn't really work out, that you now have a vertical standardization. So we have a standardized protocol. In this case, in this example, it's OpenFlow. And the idea was that you can have a single control plane and you can have a standardization in that the interface that the switch speaks to the control plane is always the same. And thereby you get the same level of standardization, just in from a different perspective. So that's my view on SDN. Basically, you can run the actual control plane somewhere else. That's actually quite simple, I think. Okay, now back to the devices. There are different approaches on how you can run software on these devices today, or basically just how you can buy these devices. You've seen this before. We have this switch here, and the switch has a CPU, which is basically this part. We have a forwarding ASIC or a chip, and we have our port. Now, if I buy a box today, it looks like this. The box I get from Cisco or Juniper or whatever other vendor is closed. I get a complete stack of software. I can't open it. It's like a Windows PC or something. And from an open source perspective, that's not very nice because I can't do anything myself. So the routing software stack is usually closed source. The operation system is closed. Might be based on open source operating system. Often it's based on something like FreeBSD or NetBSD, but you can't actually change it on the actual device. And of course the chip, the specifications are closed, and the interface that the operating system uses or the software uses to talk with the chip, of course, is also closed source, so there's actually nothing you can do with these devices. Well, you can use them, right? But if you have a great new idea, kind of sucks. And they tend to be quite expensive. Now, there's this software-defined networking idea, which I mentioned before, where you have a shift, basically, where you move this part, these OSPF, BGP, and so on, software daemons, where you move them on the centralized place on a different server, and then you can still buy these closed boxes, but it's not that bad anymore because you can still run your software as open source, which is already quite nice. Of course, it has a disadvantage that everything is remote, so you have to check if that works for your use case, depending on what you want to do. But the cool thing is now you can run most of these things as open source software. And if you check, there are a lot of projects. I didn't include it in the talk, but if you Google it, there are hundreds of open source projects that deal with exactly this part, where you can get an OpenFlow or general networking OS and run open source software with actually hardware switches, which is nice. But still not the thing that we actually want. Okay, then there's this thing called bare metal switches that came up a few years ago. And the idea of bare metal switches is it's the same model as if you buy a switch from Juniper or Cisco. It's just that you get the switch without software. Basically, like if you buy a PC without an operating system. The problem now is this forwarding chip, the specifications are, to my knowledge, and none of the cases is available online. So you still have the problem of how to access the chip. I mean, you can now run here, you can run Linux on this thing. There are a lot of projects who have mostly Debian-based Linuxes that actually come with some kind of driver here, and you can run your own router software there. So that's again like in software-defined networking, you can have your routing stack in open source, which is pretty cool, and it's done today. And it has also the slight advantage that these things are usually cheaper than if you buy them at Cisco or Juniper. But from an open source perspective, there's still the problem that in many cases, this device is not open sourced. There is one exception, however, and this is Mellanox. And we will later see in detail, but they released a driver which is integrated into the Linux kernel, and it's completely open source. Although I actually don't know how much of their chip specification is actually open. So I guess you can read the code in the Linux kernel, but I'm not entirely sure if they made the entire specification open. So there's one way to use this, like with Linux kernel, the switch dev, and another way is that something from Broadcom, it's called SDKLT. It's a C library which you can use as a basis for your own applications, but actually I haven't looked into there into detail, and I don't really know how well it works and how open it actually is. Okay, that's option three. It's cool because now we can have our own software. And I think everybody should. First option, and it is quite a new one, is called programmable hardware. What does this mean? This means that I have a forwarding chip, like today I have an x86 chip from Intel or AMD, and I can write my own programs for it. And the cool thing is here, you can do the same thing. You can write your own forwarding program, which is really cool. It has, of course, a slight advantage that this part from all vendors I saw today is still closed. So it's still part of the pipeline is closed source, but you can write your own forwarding programs, which means that you can, I don't know, if you have a nice idea on a new protocol, you can write it yourself. That's pretty cool. Usually, or today, I think the only credible language that you can use is called P4. And if you do header processing, you can basically do everything you can think of with that language. And you can actually buy hardware to do it, which is cool. But again, if it gets more interesting, like something else than hardware, than header processing, you usually end up having proprietary APIs. So in terms of features, it's pretty cool. In terms of openness, still not there, but that's where we are today. And I hope at least this step opens up a few new possibilities, because I mean, you can write these programs and you can publish them as open source, which I think is really cool. Now to the open source part. So we've seen a lot of different elements which play together, and if you write something, if you write software, it's usually all about the interfaces you can use. And this is what I try to sum up here. I'm not sure if this is the perfect abstraction layers, but it is one, and it hopefully is enough to explain what I'm talking about. So it's again the same thing that we saw before, but a little bit abstracted, again for a specific use case that you write software. So you have your chip, which is, I don't think it will ever be really open. Then you have a data plane pipeline. If you have a programmable chip, you can write it your own. You can write your own pipeline. If you have most chips that you buy today, they are fixed function pipelines, which means the pipeline is given. You cannot change it. But hopefully, or in some cases, you still can see how the pipeline works and can program it. Then you have the actual driver to the pipeline, which can be open or not. We've seen before that today, in many cases, we have open source drivers, or in some cases, and that's the actual thing that you usually think about. You want to write an application and do something in the network. And that's why you usually care for the control application. And each layer here is something that you usually could have a specification on. And each arrow is an API, more or less. And now, of course, you could think about every step here. But we will focus on this part. So basically, how would I call, or how would I talk with my control plane application with my chip driver? How does it look like? And I think that's the most interesting part here. Okay, now the question is, what's an API and how does it help us to understand which point is the right point if I want to do something with open source? Where should I start? And Yeah, as I said before, if you write a program, you usually write it against an API. An API is, well, usually it's just a list of functions, but implicit, if it's not explicit, you have a data model, things that you can actually talk about, you have functions that you can call, and you have protocols, usually something like a list of or an order in which you have to call specific functions. And, well, it's kind of a simple language, an API, and it tells me what I can talk about and what I can express in this API. And if I write a program for a specific API, I'm usually, well, attached to this API and have to go with it. And of course, there it helps if I have some kind of standard, so at least some kind of standard way of thinking, right? So if somebody comes up with a great new idea, it takes time to learn that. So it usually helps if you have some kind of standardization. When it's not in the exact API, then at least in the kind of thinking that you have. And that's what I would call data plane models. I'm not sure if this is the best name, but at least that's my take on it. And in the classical networking case, if you do networking today, mostly, at least that's my impression, what you think about is you have routers, you have switches, and usually everything else is a middle box. What does that mean? Well, a router takes an IP address, checks for the destination IP address, or takes a packet, checks the destination IP address, has some kind of routing table, or if it's in a data plane, it's actually a forwarding information base, checks which interface it should go to and what's the next hop, rewrites the destination MAC address, and sends out the packet. So that's the general idea. Of course, today you have some advanced functionality like tunneling protocols and queuing, but in terms of header processing, for example, that's usually what you think about. A router forwards packets, that's it. Then you have switches, which is similar, but just based on the MAC address, and you usually don't even modify the packet at all. That's a nice thing. If you have a very simple network, that's usually a cool thing to have, and it really helps you to think about networks because you have to have some kind of mental model for it. The problem is everything that's not a router or switch is a middle box. And a lot of things you have today in networks are middle boxes. And that's kind of, well, it's not ideal, I would say. On the other hand, of course, it's really good. Everybody knows this kind of stuff. It's well understood. Linux kernel, for example, is based on this kind of model. Most of the routing software you find today expect this kind of interface. And most hardware even that you can buy today is the same. They are based on this model. The disadvantage, of course, is if you want to do something else, something different than routing or switching, you're kind of lost because usually these interfaces do not allow this. So if you have a great new idea on what to do in networks, you probably aren't going to be able to do it with this kind of API. Nevertheless, of course, they are very useful if you just want a router or a switch. And there are different implementations of this interface. One of those is the switch abstraction interface. That's from the Open Compute project. And if you buy, for example, a switch from Broadcom, you can get a software that actually offers you a switch abstraction interface. I think most vendors today do this. So it might be closed source, which in this case, these cases I listed here are. So you still need a closed source binary driver, but at least you have an open interface. So if you just want to do routing and switching, you can more or less buy every bare metal switch on the market, and you will get this for free. Which is also nice, already nice, because, well, you can write your own software and you don't really need to buy a Cisco switch anymore. Another approach is Linux Switch Dev. I mentioned that before. This is completely open source. It's part of the Linux kernel. That's really cool and really nice, and it's completely integrated in the Linux kernel, as I understand it. The only drawback is that the only supported device, to my knowledge, is this SN2000 series from Mellanox. And these devices are really, really expensive. So this is kind of a drawback. So if you want to do something yourself, I'll have prices in the end, but they are like something like starting at 15,000 euros, so that's a lot. Even at our university, we were not able to convince anybody to buy us such a device. This traditional, the classical view on networks, it's nice. It can work today if you just want to do routing and switching. If you want to do anything else, that's not really the thing. We talked about software-defined networking before. The software-defined networking idea comes with the OpenFlow standard, and that, as you hopefully remember, was this protocol you can speak with your centralized controller and your data plane box somewhere in the field. And the Open Networking Foundation came up with this, and the idea is to abstract this model or to generalize the model of the router and the switch that we discussed before. So the idea is to find some more basic things you can do on packets, or you can structure your pipeline to make sure that you can express more things that are not just limited to routing and switching. And the ideas they had was, well, in some way, or if you buy a switch today, they are mostly a pipeline of tables. And in these tables, it's usually like this. You get a packet in. You have, they call it a flow table in OpenFlow, but could be a routing table in a classical router. You have some kind of matcher. In a routing table, this would be you match the destination IPv4 address. You have an order of rules, and the first rule that matches has attached some instructions on what to do with the packet. If it's a IPv4 router, you would say, say decrement the time to live and send out on this port and at this MAC address. So this is the basic idea. And if you think about it, you can do most of the things you can do in networking with this kind of abstraction. So the OpenFlow idea is you have a lot of these tables, and you can change the packet on the fly with these instructions, or basically collect instructions that are executed in the end. So it's much more abstract. I hope it's not too abstract to understand, actually, if you haven't seen this before. But the general idea is you take a packet, you pass the headers, you have a series of tables you can match for specific features in the tables. And if the packet matches for the same rule, you would call it a flow. And that's why it's called OpenFlow. And by doing that, you are quite flexible. And it's kind of a neat idea. One thing that you should remember, of course, when we talk about pipelines, is that we have this series of tables, but you can never get backwards. Basically, you cannot have a loop, because if you want low latency, you cannot have loops. That doesn't work. So the idea is that in the pipeline, you always go forward, never backward. So that's the basic idea. Now, in the implementation, it turned out it wasn't. Well, the idea is cool, it was progress, but it didn't really work out in the end. This is an example of an actual Broadcom switch and its actual OpenFlow tables. As you can see, there are a lot of tables, and the point is, this is again a model, it's not the actual hardware. So it's still an abstraction layer. And what's interesting about this, and this is something the OpenFlow people found out very late, is that, I think it's hard to read. So this is basically the incoming port, and then you have a series of tables. Ingress port, VLAN, MAC termination, unicast routing, policy ACL, and I can't even read it myself. Better contrast next time. Okay, so the point is, this is the classical pipeline thing that we saw on the last slide. The problem is not all of these tables are the same. So they are very different. So there are tables like the policy ACL table, where you can have more complex matches, where you, while on the other hand, you have this ingress port table, which has a very, very restricted set of operations you can do. In this case, here's the match that you can match the in port and the Ethernet type. And everything you can do is you can go to the VLAN table. Okay? And if you thought about the pipeline model in the last slide. When you read it the first time, you envision much more complex things. In any case, it turned out that OpenFlow didn't think about this early enough, so they had to come up with some kind of additional concept where you could restrict the actions or the things you can do in a table. Because in the end, if you write your program, you don't want to change your program from every switch. The idea was originally that you have one interface, you write your program, and you're done. Now, if you have to change it for every switch, because every switch is different and have different features here, and you have these additional attributes, that's not really working out. And it's actually still not really solved today. So this wasn't the real drawback of OpenFlow. I think the reason why it, I think it's, nowadays it's pronounced dead. So stuff still exists, and I think it's very interesting to use as an example for centralized controller network. The protocol itself is probably not going to see big deployments anymore. The cool thing about OpenFlow is it had this idea of this match action tables, which is a really, really good idea, I think. And you could have remote controllers, which is also very nice in some use cases, I think. Now, the main problem was that the matches and action fields, they were defined in the standard. And you can see here an image that's taken from a paper. It's from 2012, so it's not even the newest one. And you can see in OpenFlow version 1.0, the number of different match fields in total were 20. And with OpenFlow 1.4, we had much, much more. We had, you think, 41 different match fields. So basically, every time somebody comes up with a new protocol, you have to come up with a new match field and you have to change the standard. That's not the ideal approach. And the same thing goes for action. So basically, if you can remove a specific header field or write to it, it's always a different action. And every time you have something new, it has to go on the standard. So I would say it was a nice step in the right direction, but it didn't really work out because if you have a new protocol, you still can't do it, and it's much more complex than the traditional networking model. I mean, you still can build a router with that, but in the traditional abstraction layer, you can just tell the router, install a router, and you're done. And here you have to do it yourself, so it's more complicated, but you don't really have a reward for it. So it's nice, but probably mostly academic. Now, these people thought, well, before we go on, there are two examples of stuff that you can actually use if you want to try it out. This is actually what we use at university. There are mainly two different OpenFlow implementations. One is from Broadcom, it's called OFDPA, and it's important because if you buy a switch today, Broadcom switches are simply the cheapest, while still being reasonably good. And yeah, actually working quite nice. If you have a switch, I'll show that again in the end. If you want to do something yourself, this is a nice way to start. Of course, there's a drawback that the driver is closed, but still you can download it on GitHub, so it's nice. If you want a little more convenient approach, because the OFDPA model is not always adhering in all the details to the OpenFlow standard, you can use PicOS, which is open vSwitch-based OpenFlow agent. However, you have to pay for it. It's closed source. But it has some neat options. So for example, you can combine the traditional routing and switching model with the OpenFlow pipeline embedded in it, so you can do very interesting things. Again, if you want to use it in production, I don't know. But for experimenting, I think it's quite nice. OK, now to the next step in the development, which is called P4. So we've seen the switch abstraction layer, the traditional approach where you have routers and routers and switches. Then we saw OpenFlow, which was kind of failed, but a nice approach. And now the same guys who did OpenFlow thought, well, why not do the next step? And they came up with a thing called P4. I can't actually even really say what P4 is. Is it a language? Is it a specification? Is it an architecture? They're putting a lot of stuff in there. I used it first and foremost as a language, but it comes also with an architecture. So what's the idea? It's basically just the next step of the OpenFlow. You saw with OpenFlow we have these protocols that are fixed in the standard, and now the idea is why not make it programmable? And the idea is that you have these match action tables still, but they are now reconfigurable, which means all the parsers or all the protocols, you have to write them yourself. And they provide a very simple switch model, which shows how this kind of pipeline works. So you have packet comes in, you have a parser, which is programmable. So you have to write it yourself. Then you have match action tables, Then you have queues and buffers, and again, match action tables, and then the packet is sent out. So very similar to OpenFlow, a little more complex with a major difference that you have a programmable parser now. And the cool is, since everything is software, of course, you cannot only, if you have your own idea for a protocol, you can write it, it's cool. But also, everything you do is available in software. So it's hopefully going to be easier to write automated management platforms, because all the way down, like it is with x86, it's all software and you can all change it yourself. Here's a small example. My impression was that not many people know before yet, so I just wanted to show how it looks like. we have here's the code. It's very simple, of course, because otherwise it wouldn't have fit in here. There are two language standards, P414 and 16. 16 is much more elaborate, but I think for understanding this is sufficient. So if you want to have a specific header field of a packet to match against, you have to parse it first. And you do this in this C-lite structure. You say header type, and then you have give just a list of fields you have in your header and the width in bits. So it's very simple. You can see source address, destination address, ether type, that's it. Then you have instantiate this. It's basically a C struct, to be honest. And then you have a parser program, and then the actual table program didn't fit, but it's actually kind of obvious. So you have a parser, which means it always starts at the parser start. You get the packet, and then you tell the parser where to go next. It goes to Ethernet, then you have the parser Ethernet. It does extract Ethernet. This is this one, so basically it just takes the next 112 bits, I think, and puts them in these fields. That's about it. And now later on you can write your own custom tables that actually do stuff with it. For example, this table reads the destination MAC address with an exact match, and then you can have different actions like drop and do nothing. So this is basically the end of the development, because now you can write your own parser. That's cool. Actually, I use this stuff, and it's really fun. I'm not sure if you're into networking and always wanted to write your own stuff. That's really cool. I really recommend it. Of course, it has some drawbacks, because, I mean, OpenFlow was nice. It was a well-defined protocol. Everything was in the standard. Now we have the problem. I mean, all this stuff is not in the standard, right? That's, I did this. So if you now want to have an API for P4, how would you do it? The first approach was, and this is, if you buy a commercial switch, this is more or less what you would do today, because that's what actually works. What you do is you basically get an auto-generated API that you can use in your program, and it will just use the names that you use here. So you write a program, and you have a table called filter, and then you will have some IP calls in your API where you can actually put rules in this table called filter. And of course, it works let's put it like this. But of course, if you change the names in your program, you have to rewrite all your control plane as well, and all your tests. And that's getting cumbersome over time. And that's why they came up with some kind of successor to OpenFlow, I think, is their idea. It's called P4 Runtime, and it has an advantage over OpenFlow in that it actually enables you to write or to run local control programs and remote control programs, so you're not fixed to one part of the spectrum that you can be at. And basically the idea is that you have some kind of basic protocol, like gRPC for remote access, or protobufs for the data types, and they try to build an ecosystem so that when you write a program, you can more or less automatically map to these data structure that you get from the data plane. How well this works, I haven't tried it yet, but I think right now it's the most interesting approach if you want to actually write your own data plane protocols. Okay, so what's the advantage? I just said that it's the most generic model yet. And again, if you want to do more than just having a router or a switch, I think this is the way to go. The packet pipeline, if you come with a new protocol, you can write it yourself, and it can be open source, most of it at least. And my opinion pretty much solves the problem of packet header processing. What it does not solve yet is everything else. So if you, for example, want to do queuing or encryption or something like that, everything that's little more than packet header processing, is everything that, for example, changes the whole payload, for example, of a packet, that's usually not something that you can do today, because in P4 you only can change the things that you can get, that you can parse in your parser. And if you wanted to encrypt the packet, you would have to parse the complete packet, and that doesn't really work, I think. So that's not, there are still some things that need to be done. The problem is the API I just saw, said, it's pretty new. So you would have to check if the thing you want to do is actually in there. The basic API I explained in the last slide, where you can just have the name of the tables and the names of your objects in your program, that actually works. I actually worked with that last year, and it was really cool. The problem, well, the next problem is that while P4 itself is an open standard, if you wanted to use it with an actual hardware device, you have to rely on a closed source driver and compiler, which is sad. Maybe this changes in the future, or hopefully it does, but right now that's where we are at. And well, if you want to have something like encryption or so on, it can be integrated, but it's usually then proprietary and you can't open source it. Okay, so no examples here, because I will now directly go to the part. If you're interested and want to do something yourself, or if you look at the prices, maybe, I don't know, at your university or your local CCC group or whatever. If you want to have the classical data plane model, I think the best approach is to use this switch testing. It's in the Linux kernel. They have regular updates, they have a nice documentation, and for a half-sized switch, which means it's just half a rack, with 16 ports, you pay like 9,000 euros. That's unfortunately a little expensive. And the thing, at least, I just Googled, I don't want to do advertisements here, so I didn't put the link there, but if you Google it yourself, it's pretty easy to find. It comes with Cumulus Linux. My understanding is it's based on Linux, but it's not really free, so I'm not sure if you want to hack yourself if you can actually do that. So theory is great, practice, I'm not entirely sure, because I haven't tried, so if anybody knows, I would be interested. The other thing is, if you want to use OpenFlow, I think that's the easiest way today, because you can get very cheap switches. This is the 10 gigabit switch, but if you want just the 1 gigabit switch, you can get one for 1,500 euros, and then you would have to get commercial software, but I would say about 2,000 euros and you should be good. The good thing about OFDPA that works on this switch is it's not perfect, but it's free, and you don't have to pay any subscription or whatever. And you can use the USDN framework, which is, if you want to experiment yourself, really nice. And by the way, if it doesn't have to be high performance, you can just get Open vSwitch, which comes with every Linux distribution, and you can basically build your own router. But of course, that's not high performance, so it doesn't fit the title. Then we have the P4 data plane model. If you want something affordable, you can buy these Netronome Agilio CX networking cards. The P4 support is actually a little bit like put on top of the software stack later on, but it still works. Again, we have those at university, and they're actually working quite fine. Except just they only have two ports, and well, they're like a networking card and not really a switch. But it's, I think, quite nice to get started. And of course, if you want the real thing, you can buy this 65 ports, 100 gigabit device. We got one at university, really cheap. I think if you normally buy it, it's quite expensive. But again, I mean, you get like the fastest switch ever, and you can program it yourself, which I think is a really cool thing. It is quite fun. Problem again, if you want to do something with it, you will have to sign an NDA with Barefoot Networks to get their proprietary tools. which is again a drawback from the open source perspective. But of course, you get included, as I showed before, you get included this 8-core CPU. You can, do quite interesting stuff with it. And if you don't have the money for that, maybe you should ask your local university or hacker club or whatever if they might want to invest this kind of money for some progress of the world or whatever. Okay, that's about it on my talk. I hope I gave you some insight on what you can do today and some ideas maybe of what you might want to do. And if you have any questions, I'd be happy to answer them. Thank you.
So, questions? No questions? Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And, yeah. Great round of applause.